You are here, moving in the midst. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, working in this place. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, moving in our midst. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, working in this place. I worship you. I worship you. You are waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are here, touching every heart. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, healing every heart. Oh, I worship you. Jesus, I worship you. Turn the lives around. You are here. Turning lives around. I worship you. I worship you. You bend in every heart. You are here. You are bending every heart. I worship you. I worship you, Lord. You are waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Yeah, you're the waymaker. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Yeah, sing it again. You are, yeah. Waymaker,
you never stop working. Good morning, everyone. Isn't this exciting? Different, but exciting. I'd like to welcome you to the Gathering Place Community Church, Ridgetown, Ontario. We've got friends from far and wide who are joining us, and this is kind of exciting. So I'm seeing that, we've got some friends from previous churches and some college students. I've got some friends from Florida, Margaret and Larry, Margaret Rose and Larry Burke just joined. And Caden, are you there? I understand it was your birthday this week. Are you there, Caden? Anyway, I'm Pastor Doug Rowley, and I'm streaming live from my home today. The music that you just heard is Waymaker by Leland. And the lyrics, our God is a waymaker, miracle worker, light in the darkness. And those are encouraging words for us to listen to during these very interesting, unique days. Before we get too far in, I want to just kind of give you a thumbs up and let you know that we do have something for the kids in a few minutes. Ask them to hold on and be patient. We're going to get there very soon. But let me just make a comment on what's going on in our world. We know we're meeting this morning by way of technology because our world is experiencing a pandemic. And we have to practice social distancing, which is a way to limit and to slow down the spread of this virus and thus save lives. Pandemics, if you know anything about pandemics, it's serious business. This is not a drill. This is the real thing. And by now you should understand how important it is that you follow the rules of hygiene, disinfecting, avoiding contact outside your home. And of course, it's inconvenient. We have to be selfless. It's not just about you and I, it's about everyone else. And it's a matter of life and death. So, we are the people of God, and with this, we're going to turn the inconveniences into opportunities. We're going to take the lemons and make some lemonade, and we're going to make the best of this. You know what I was thinking, though? I'm thanking God for technology. At least we have that to keep us connected. We have lovely homes to enjoy. We have advanced medical knowledge. If you know anything about other plagues from other centuries, they did not have these privileges, so we are in good shape, comparatively speaking. Now, you're wondering, how are we going to worship in the coming weeks? Well, we're going to worship just like this. I'm going to meet you here. We're going to have a worship service. We're going to have a word from God's Word. I will be fully clothed, I assure you, but you can be in your pajamas. You can be sipping on some coffee and or a tea, eating your cereal. It doesn't matter. And each week we're going to have something for the kids, which is going to be called Lessons from Beanie Boos. You'll hear about that and see that in a moment. And we'll try to improve the technology as we go forward. You see a little glare in my glasses. That's not actually from the lights around. It's from the monitor in front of me. So I'm not sure how to fix that, but we'll try to address that as well. So I see that, hi, Glennis. It's nice to see you with us, Leoni and Jennifer Hoskins. These are just some of the people, St. Catherine, Casey, so nice to have you with us. We're praying for Jan these days, and this is really exciting. It's going to help if you have a Bible on your lap. We don't have the wherewithal to put the scripture verses on a screen for you, so I usually use the NIV, the King James Version, when I use the Psalms. And so that's what we'll do. And we're going to begin with a call to worship. Now, how will we do a call to worship? Well, I'm going to use Psalm 46 this morning. And your part at home is to be responsive. Your part is to say, therefore, we will not fear. Try it. Therefore, we will not fear. That's your part, all right? And every time I put up my hand, you'll know it's your cue, okay? Let's try it. Therefore, we will not fear. So here we go, Psalm 46. This is our call to worship. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in times of trouble. Therefore, we will not fear. Though the earth give away and the mountains fall into the heart of the sea, though its waters roar and foam and the mountains quake with their surging, there is a river whose streams make glad the city of God, the holy place where the Most High dwells. Therefore, we will not fear. God is within her. She will not fall. God will help her at the break of day. Therefore, we will not fear. Nations are in uproar. Kingdoms fall. He lifts his voice. The earth melts. Therefore, we will not fear. The Lord Almighty is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. Therefore, we will not fear. Come and see what the Lord has done, the desolations he has brought on the earth. He makes wars cease to the ends of the earth. He breaks the bow, shatters the spear. He burns the chariots with fire. Therefore, we will not fear. He says, be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth. The Lord Almighty is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. Therefore, we will not fear. Psalm 95, verse 6. Come, let us now bow down in worship. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker, for he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture, and the flock under his care. Will you bow your heads with me as we pray? God of all creation, maker of heaven and earth, we call upon you in Jesus' name. We enter your presence with thanksgiving in our hearts, knowing that we have lived with such tremendous blessing. And it's hard for us today to pare back and to find ourselves limited in a number of ways. But we thank you for the blessings even in the midst of this new season. Medical knowledge, safe homes, provision, people that care for us. Above all else, Lord, we have you, or rather, you have us. And where there is reason for us to be afraid, you tell us not to fear, because you are stronger and more powerful than any virus or Goliath, and our earthly lives and eternal ones are in your hands. So we worship by listening and responding to your word this morning. Bring us to a place of calm and comfort that goes beyond reason. This is still Lent, and we're moving with Jesus to the cross, where you showed your ultimate love for us. It is time that we humbled ourselves and turned from our selfish ways. Forgive us, O Lord, and we turn back to you, and we know that you do forgive. A special prayer is sent up for our frontline workers that have to risk more than the rest of us. We're praying for those down on Erie Beach and Erie O. Add insult to injury, they're worried about their homes. And a special prayer is sent for those unable to return home, or those who are coming home and are facing quarantine because of the illness. God be with them. Help them to be settled and to enjoy the quietness. We pray for Jan Huseman. We pray for Ron and Brian, Irene and Auntie Jean, Diane and Laura. I have a friend, Dawn, who's struggling from Blenheim. We pray for all these people and many more. We pray for our children that are understandably confused and disoriented with all that's going on. We just pray, Lord, that you would give us wisdom and patience, and above all else, repentant hearts, for this is a season when we can be drawn closer to you, so that you be drawn closer to us. We ask this in Jesus' name. And everyone said, Amen. Now, we're going to have the kids gather around the computer, and we're going to see if we can get something going here. If I can learn how to use my technology, which I sometimes have trouble doing. Here we go. Recognize that, boys and girls? Camera's going to get blurry for a second, but be patient. Thank you. welcome, boys and girls. Let's get this right. Here we go. There we go. Make sure it stays in place. This isn't Disney Studios, is it? There we go. Welcome, boys and girls, to Lessons from Beanie Boos! From the world of Beanie Boos, we will learn some amazing things about God and lessons from the Bible. This morning, I would like you to meet Jesus. Hi, Jesus. Good morning. Now, Jesus was sent to us from God, and in a wonderful way, he was God. Some people would call him the Lion of Judah. While he was here, he chose 12 friends. Oh, they weren't the most popular. 4 of them were fishermen. They stunk like fish, and sometimes they smelled like sweat. Well, here's the first one, Simon Peter. Hi, Simon. Good morning. He was always getting in trouble for speaking when he should have been listening. Andrew was Simon's brother. He was the one who said to Jesus, "We don't have enough to feed the 5,000. And then there were the brothers James and John, also fishermen. They had nicknames, the Sons of Thunder. Oh, they were boisterous. John was the one fellow who wrote a gospel, the story of Jesus, and he described himself as someone whom Jesus really loved. Philip was the sort who didn't understand things as fast as other people. I'm thinking he struggled in school.
Aww.
Nathaniel had a good heart. He was very humble, but sometimes Nathaniel could be a little rude. He once said to Jesus, "Can any good thing come out of Nazareth?" Oh, Nathaniel, some things you should just keep inside, your inside voice. Then there was Matthew. Not too many people liked Matthew. When they saw him coming, they hid because he was a tax collector. And in the time of Jesus, that meant he was a thief. He stole money.
Boo!
Now, Thomas, we find out, was an all-or-nothing kind of person. If he's happy, he was really happy. And if he was grouchy, he was really grouchy. He wasn't going to believe people just because they said something. He wanted to see everything for himself. And then there was another James, a second James. His nickname was James the Less. Huh, what a nickname. Was he skinnier than everyone else? Was he dumber? Did he appear less than anyone else? Was he worthless? Did he feel helpless? Maybe useless? Well, he was a wallflower. But you know, Jesus picked him. And then there was Simon the Zealot.
Freedom!
Freedom! This was someone who thought he could use violence to get what he wanted. He used swords. Jesus did not want people to use swords. But Jesus picked him anyway. Then there was Judas Iscariot. He was really good with counting money. But there was something about him that made it hard to trust him. Look into his eyes. Well, we'll learn something about him next week. Bum, 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 bum. And did you know there was another Judas? That's right. Everybody referred to him as Judas, not Iscariot. We never hear him speak. Nothing else is ever said about him. He's a complete wallflower, almost invisible. Well, Jesus saw him, and Jesus wanted him to be part of his special group of friends. And here's what we learned, boys and girls. Jesus was not looking for perfect people, but people who are willing to be perfected. Jesus was not looking for people that didn't have an unblemished past, but a willingness to make a better future. And each of Jesus's friends had one thing in common. They were all willing to follow him. Jesus picks people simply because they're willing to follow him. And I'm guessing, well, I know, that Jesus has you picked as well to be part of his family.
Yay!
So next week, we will meet these same friends around a big supper table that they shared, and we'll learn something more. Oh, keep your eye on Judas. There's something about him. Join us next Sunday for Lessons from Beanie Boos! Well, how did you like that, boys and girls? That was a little silly fun, wasn't it? A silly way of being serious. And next week, we'll be looking at the supper that Jesus had with his friends. And there's some pretty interesting things that happened at that supper table. Some announcements for the church family. What we're doing is each day of the week, Monday through Friday, you can meet me here at 9 a.m. for something called Bite Size prayer pockets, or no, so I'm sorry, I got the wrong thing going on there, for our bite-sized daily bread. And I'll be sharing a brief devotion to start your day, and so that'll be a live feed at 9 a.m. We did one as a test on Saturday, and I noticed that within 12 hours there was 350 people that had already signed in. So that tells you what's going on in the hearts and minds of people around us. We need to hear from God during these times. Also, we're starting something called prayer pockets. That's where I got a little confused. That's groups of six people that'll be meeting again by way of Facebook Messenger, and there'll be a facilitator with a short devotion. We'll have 15-minute prayer times. If you want to be part of those, be once or twice a week. It's a way that we can stay connected and we can pray together about what's going on in the world and our lives. Offerings. I know you guys still want to support your church, and rightly so. This is something that God has called us to do, and just because the doors are closed doesn't mean we don't have expenses. And we still want to provide missions offerings to the world. So this is how you do it. We're accepting e-transfers. You just go to your online banking site, and you find an e-transfer button, and you choose the payee, type in the Gathering Place Community Church, and then they'll want some identification. The email that you'll put in is TGPCC, the Gathering Place Community Church, treasurer@gmail.com. And so it's that easy, and you can transfer money to the church, and you will send also to the treasurer a security word, so that we can make it happen, and that keeps everything going. And so be faithful to the Lord as we continue on. Remain steadfast in all areas of your life. And one thing I want to add, which echoes what I shared Saturday morning, is just fill your home, the environment, with positivity. Christian music, turn off the noise from the 24/7 news cycle, and keep your heart turned on to the Lord. Well, we're about to go to the Word. And as we do, I'm just going to take 30 seconds and play something. If George and Ethel are there, I was thinking of you, George and Ethel, as I selected this song. Turn your eyes upon Jesus.
Oh, soul, are you weary and troubled? No light in the darkness you see. There's light for a look at the Savior, and life more abundant and free. Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in his wonderful grace, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace.
Well, we're going to turn to God's Word. I'm seeing that some other friends have joined us, and here's a wonderful surprise. How many of you remember Esau, who's from Trinidad and is a dear friend of mine and has spoken in our church when he's visited Canada? Esau from Trinidad is with us this morning. Good morning, Esau, and it's wonderful to have you with us. Kimberly, Linda, I'm just seeing names as they come on the screen, and there seems to be quite a large church out there, so this is wonderful. Now, you might wonder what I'm going to speak on this morning, especially an occasion like this, but for me, it's straightforward. It's really not complicated at all. Long before this corona stuff happened, I was at a prayer retreat, as I often do. I go to meet with God and to get some direction from the Lord. And I was planning for Lent 2020 and what I would share with the people that are associated with the gathering place. And I decided, as the Lord led me, to follow Jesus for his last week up unto the crucifixion. And we would start with the Sunday, the first day of the week, and move forward to Good Friday and see what Jesus did on each day days of those week. And that would become the foundation for what I share with each of you. So a couple weeks ago, we called it Thank God It's Sunday, and we looked at Jesus riding on the back of a colt into Jerusalem for the Palm Parade. And then the following Sunday, we called it Thank God It's Monday, and we saw Jesus enter back into Jerusalem by way of a fruitless fig tree, talking to us using a living metaphor about being fruitful. And then he went into Jerusalem. He chased out the money changers because they were making the house of prayer a den of thieves. And then the following week, thank God it's Tuesday, we looked at the widow who gave her all two mites. And that brings us to today. Although it's Sunday, in terms of our Lenten theme, we're calling it Thank God It's Wednesday. What did Jesus do on Wednesday? And so I'm going to speak on the biblical passage that was predetermined by the series long before the coronavirus was introduced to us. And our passage today is from Luke chapter 21 and Matthew 24. This is something that Jesus spoke about now just 2 days before the crucifixion. And his disciples approached him and they said, Jesus, what will the sign of your coming and of the end of the age be? What a topic. And Jesus enters into the realm of prophecy. And Luke, being the medical doctor, hi, Lizza out there, Dr. Lizza, he specifically remembers a medical portion of the prophecy. And in Luke chapter 21, one of the things he mentions is pestilences in various places. I couldn't have planned this. This was God. Pestilence is a fatal epidemic disease, especially the bubonic plague. So that is a pestilence. COVID-19 is a modern day pestilence. And it's why we're quarantining ourselves. I'm not a doomsday kind of person. And I will not draw premature conclusions this morning. But what I would like to do with you is let the words of Jesus speak to us. And I'll make some comments that are following. All right. So thank God it's Wednesday. Wednesday, the final week of Jesus' life before the resurrection. And this is something that Jesus said to his disciples. We begin at verse 5. Some of his disciples were remarking about how the temple was adorned with beautiful stones and with gifts dedicated to God. But Jesus said, as for what you see here, the time will come when not one stone will be left on another. Every one of them will be thrown down. Teacher, they asked, when will these things happen? And what will be the sign that they are about to take place? He replied, watch out that you are not deceived, for many will come in my name, claiming, I am he, and the time is near. Don't follow them. When you hear of wars and uprisings, do not be frightened. These things must happen first, but the end will not come right away. Then he said to them, Nation will rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom. There will be great earthquakes, famines, and pestilences in various places, and fearful events and great signs from heaven. Now, we're going to leave it there for this morning, although I am going to reference, as we go further, many other verses in the same chapter in Matthew 24 that Jesus spoke of. But I'm wondering, does Jesus have your attention? Let's talk about it. Plagues, pestilence. Ugh. The bubonic plague in times past was the cause of numerous pandemics and epidemics. In the 6th century, there was something called the plague of Justinian. It claimed as many as 25 million lives. It caused famines and a lot of devastation. This is serious business. In the 1300s, there was a pestilence called the Black Death. It wiped out 50 million people, more than half the population of Europe at the time. And that was the feeder for the Italian plague of 1629. Even after the Black Death ended, for centuries to follow, it would sporadically rear its ugly head and cause another 280,000 people in Italy, Verona, to pass away. There was the Great Plague of London, 1665. At its peak, it took some 8,000 people each week. 100,000 people eventually died. And then there was the third pandemic, and that happened in the 1800s. That too began in China, and it took 15 million Oriental lives. Now, each of these pandemics could have been interpreted by the followers of Jesus as fulfillment of the words that Jesus spoke as a sign of his coming. Each of them could have been. And now that we're facing the coronavirus, and we may wonder if this is also a sign of his coming. Well, you should wonder. I think that's why Jesus shared these things, so that we would pause and take a look and consider what is happening in our world and what this means in terms of his coming. Now, the reason that Jesus even spoke about things was in response to some comments that his disciples made about the temple that they were visiting. They were admiring the temple, the huge stones, all the adornments, and they were really impressed with the grandeur and its beauty. And then Jesus said that, he said this in verse 34 later on, I tell you, this generation will certainly not pass away until all of these things have happened. And he talks about how the temple will be destroyed within a generation. And do you know that within a generation, which is 40 years, the very same temple he was talking about was destroyed by the Romans in 70 AD. That gives credibility to the prophetic capacity of Jesus and to the rest of everything else he said. His words were true. Now, in verse 29 of Luke 21, Jesus makes reference again to the fig tree. As we learned a couple Sundays ago on Thank God It's Monday, the fig tree was used to symbolize many things in Jewish life. In the spring, the fig tree would put out leaves, and those leaves would indicate that the winter was past, the spring was now upon people, and that the summer was coming. So it was a sign that summer was coming. And in verse 29, Jesus said that all these signs, including earthquakes, pandemics, would be indicators like leaves on a fig tree, that he would be returning. That's what he said. And because the prophet Jeremiah also referenced the fig tree, symbolic of Israel, the people of Israel, he used figs specifically, many scholars believe that these verses about the fig tree showing signs that summer is coming by its leaves germinating and being shown was an indicator, again, that, or when Israel was established in 1948, that was a fulfillment of that prophecy. the establishment of Israel, gathering the people of God together in their homeland, the prophetic land that was promised to Abraham and expanded in terms of the Mosaic covenant. And with each successive war, the Jewish people have claimed more land that's in keeping with that covenant. Most scholars believe it's prophetic of that, and we saw that fulfilled in 1948. Well, prophecy is better understood in hindsight. Too many persons have gotten carried away and believed that they understood the specifics and they've made outlandish predictions. We don't want to do that. The point of Jesus' words here is that his people are in a position of readiness. He said in verse 28, "When these things begin to take place, stand up and lift up your heads because your redemption is drawing near." That's what he said. He said in verse 36, "Be always on the watch and pray that you may be able to escape all that is about to happen, and that you may be able to stand before the Son of Man." So, is this coronavirus a sign of his coming? What do you think? If we cross-reference this portion of Scripture with Matthew 24, which was the same conversation he was having with the disciples, Matthew includes something that Luke does not. He refers to the days of Noah. Matthew 24, verse 37. He says, "As it was in the days of Noah, so it will be in the coming of the Son of Man. For the days before the flood, people were eating, drinking, marrying, and giving in marriage." People could marry whoever they wanted. "Up to the day Noah entered the ark. And they knew nothing about what would happen until the flood came and took them all away. That is how it will be at the coming of the Son of Man." Is the culture that we're living in similar to the days of Noah? Have the moral standards of our culture squeezed the Ten Commandments out? What do you think? Does everyone do what is right in their own eyes? Live and let live? And has God, even for the average follower of Jesus, become more of a convenience than a commitment? Let's revisit some of the other specifics Jesus mentions as indicators of his soon coming. Back to Luke, he talks about false Christs, false Christ messiahs. I went to Wikipedia and I learned that there have been 72 noted, these are just the ones that found traction amongst the larger population, 72 persons who have professed to be the Messiah and gathered followers. We know of the Moonies, their founder, Sun Myen Moon, David Koresh, the Bab of the Baha'i Faith. Those are just to name a few. But even Muhammad is a Christ-like figure who professes to be God's more current prophet, and Jesus was just a previous prophet. But today is Muhammad is God's prophet. That's what they say. Well, Jesus was right. Wars? Well, there's always been wars and rumors of war. Nation has always been against nation, kingdom against kingdom. So this seems like it's obvious. I mean, with good reason, the Second World War, people thought that that was the fulfillment of this prophecy and that Hitler was the Antichrist. But now in the atomic age, we know that the Second World War looks like a picnic by comparison. So there's still wars, there's still rumors of wars. Great earthquakes, this is interesting. Jesus said there would be great earthquakes. He didn't say small earthquakes, he said great earthquakes. Do you know, in terms of earthquakes throughout history, there hasn't really been a substantial increase of earthquakes. There's been kind of an average, the same amount every year. And now since we've been able to record them, that's become even more evident. But what has changed is the increase in great earthquakes. Every scientist, seismologist worth their salt, will immediately notice that the biggest earthquakes, magnitude of over 9, have taken place over the last 60 years. There's never been a 10, ever, but there's been 5 over 9 since 1952. Great earthquakes. That's new in the last 60 years. And then famines. Jesus talked about famines. Well, there's always been famines. And actually, the rate of deaths relative to famines has decreased, I think, because of the world's ability to bring food in and things like that. But famines occur often in tandem with weather shifts, which we are experiencing, with war, and always with pestilence. So Jesus also adds one more thing. Great signs from the heavens. And this is a curious one. John Hagee went out on a limb a number of years ago, and he referenced three passages in the Bible that speak of eclipses and blood moons. There's been four blood moons, they call it a tetrad, that occurred in 2014 and 15. That is four full lunar eclipses without partial eclipses in between. And in 2014 and 15, blood moons fell on the first day of the Feast of Passover and the first day of the Feast of Tabernacles. Signs in the heavens. Well, Jesus made reference that there'd be some strange things. Back in the 70s and 80s, amongst evangelical Christians, there was this incredible emphasis on the return of Christ. Hal Lindsey wrote The Late Great Planet Earth. There was a whole movie series that was prefaced by, what was the title, The Thief in the Night. And everybody, when I became a Christian, was talking about biblical prophecy from Revelation, who the Antichrist might be, a one-world monetary system, taking the mark on your body, and then the emphasis has kind of just faded out. But thank God it's Wednesday. Jesus spoke 2 days before his crucifixion. And I cannot say that I understand it all. I can't say how it will happen. I can't even tell you when it will happen. But I do know that the earth seems to be groaning with global warming, concern over fresh water supply, great earthquakes, and tsunamis and things like that. Another pandemic. Now you're at home, and we're all trying to be wise, and we're praying that our lives will be saved, and that we will return to normal life soon, and that's what we should pray. But what if that's not the case? What if? What if what Jesus was speaking about, this is the threshold. We have to ask ourselves the question, seriously, are we on good terms with God? Can you lift up your heads because your redemption is drawing near? Brandon, I think you're out there, Brandon Dom. And I was remembering a story when we were on one of our mission trips to the Dominican Republic. And we, as a group, were about to go off to another site for worship service. And we were all in the bus, but where was Brandon? We waited and we waited and we waited, and he wasn't there, and we didn't know where he was. The group decided to tell the bus driver to engage the gears and to leave without him. Brandon's never forgotten that. He says, I can't believe my group left me. He found a taxi and he found us. He caught up. But he just wasn't ready. This is what Jesus is talking about. When he tells the parable of the bridegroom and his bride, and he's coming for her, that she's supposed to have her lamp trimmed and burning. That's what he's saying. Come on, church. Be ready. The message of Paul, who said Jesus is coming for a bride that's without spot or wrinkle. He's talking about people who take their lives seriously and God's commands seriously. That we're not allowing spots, the world, to contaminate us from the outside, or to affect us from the inside out, wrinkles. He's talking about keeping a distance from sin and living our lives for God. So wherever recent world events fit into the prophetic agenda, this Sunday is a good Sunday for you to return to God. Because I know you've been thinking about God. What's next? And these things happen, and providence is at work. One of the good things that comes is the people wake up and they remember the Lord their God. He's the maker of heaven and earth. He's the one who sustains, holds all things together, including you and I. in our lives, present and eternal, are in his hands. This is a good day to convert back to the Lord. I want to read to you another passage of scripture from 2 Peter chapter 3. Above all, you must understand that in the last days, scoffers will come, scoffing and following their own evil desires. They will say, "Where is this coming he promised? Ever since our ancestors died, everything goes on as has since the beginning of creation." Have you wondered that? Where is this coming he's talking about? But they deliberately forget that long ago, by God's word, the heavens came into being and the earth was formed out of water and by water. And by these waters also the world at that time was deluged and destroyed. By the same word, the present heavens and the earth are reserved for fire, being kept for the day of judgment and destruction of the ungodly. But do not forget this one thing, dear friends. With the Lord, a day is like 1,000 years, and 1,000 years are like a day. The Lord is not slow in keeping his promise, as some understand slowness. Instead, he's patient with you, not wanting anyone to perish, but everyone to come to repentance. The day of the Lord will come like a thief. The heavens will disappear with a roar. The elements will be destroyed by fire, and the earth and everything done in it will be laid bare. And since everything will be destroyed in this way, what kind of people ought you to be? You ought to live holy and godly as you look forward to the day of God and speed its coming. That day will bring about the destruction of the heavens by fire and the elements will melt by heat. But in keeping with this promise, we are looking forward to a new heaven, a new earth where righteousness dwells. So then, dear friends, since you are looking forward to this, make every effort to be found spotless, blameless, and at peace with him. Bear in mind that our Lord's patience means salvation. And therefore, dear friends, since you've been forewarned, be on your guard, so that you may not be carried away by the error of lawless and fall from your secure position, but grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. To him be both glory, both now and forever. Amen. Are you ready? It seems to me that there's hundreds listening in. And among those hundreds this morning, many people want to hear from God. You've heard Jesus' own words about the future, how it relates to perhaps what we're facing today, and what he's requiring of us. It begins with repentance, taking him seriously, finding the joy in living for him, and filling our lives with good things that flow from his presence. Will you repent with me? Will you bow your heads and pray? And let's allow God into our lives to take up residence and to be the God, the King on the throne of our hearts. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, it's your loving kindness that leads us to repentance, not fear. And so help us not to be afraid of the days to come or even what we're experiencing now, although it's a normal human reaction. Help us, Lord. But may your loving kindness, the reality that you sent your Son who gave himself upon the cross, may that be what draws us to you. And may we see our need for you, that our lives are not our own and we're not as secure as we thought we were, that everything can change in a moment. You are the one that we need to rely on. So God, we confess that we're sinners. We ask that you would forgive us of our sins. And you would help us this day to make a new start, a clean start with you. We make space in our lives for you to be not only around us, with us, but to be within us. And Lord, we're going to do our best to keep our thoughts and our minds and our lives centered upon things above and what you desire of us here below. Now grant us this peace that passes all understanding as we continue to walk with you. We thank you, God, that you are faithful and just to forgive us and to cleanse us from all sin. What a wonderful, wonderful privilege that is. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Now, friends, I'm asking that you be in touch with me. As we go forward, if you have any questions, just text me. I'm your pastor. We may not be able to see each other, you know, within 3 feet, but I'm available. All right. So you can text me. You can get a hold of me on Facebook. I really am here for you. And we are going to continue to pray for one another. I'd like you to join with me by saying the Lord's Prayer before we close. Let us say it together. Bow your heads with me. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And now, dear friends, may the Lord bless you. May the Lord keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Go now in peace and be kind to everyone you meet, because everyone you meet is fighting a hard battle. And that certainly seems to be true right now. So the Lord be with you. And we're going to close with another song, a song by Alan Jackson, another one by Alan Jackson. And this is because, well, George and Ethel love country music, and I love George and Ethel. How Great Thou Art. Folks, join me Mondays at 9 a.m. for bite-size bread, and we'll see you next Sunday, too. We are the church. You can do this.
The worlds thy hands have made. I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. When Christ shall come with shouts of acclamation and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to how great thou art. How